The following has been rated PC for politically correct.
Pay attention, you just may learn something.
It's the Sage, Larry Elder.
Now, I only blame the shooter for the shooting. I don't blame access to guns or easy access to guns, as the governor of Virginia, Terry McAuliffe, did apparently right away after the shooting, made some reference to the easy ability to get guns, and later on he admitted that he had no idea whether or not it was easy for this man to get a gun or not to get a gun. But that's what the left does. They immediately go to gun control, the way they did with the shooting up in Sandy Hook. But if we're going to talk about atmosphere, if we're going to talk about an environment that encourages people to think like victims, to think like the way Gilbert thinks, to think like apparently the way this reporter thinks, what about the Black Lives Matter movement types? The people that suggest when you're pulled over by a cop, it must be because you're racist. What about people like Eric Holder? Eric Holder is the former attorney general under Barack Obama. He's the one who said that when it comes to issues of race, America has been a nation of cowards. And he gave a speech in which he talked about what he said was pernicious racism. He said the overt, in-your-face kind of racism, that practiced by people like Donald Sterling, we can deal with that. The real issue today is pernicious racism, his word, not mine. And during the speech, he gave three examples of what he deemed to be pernicious racism. Now, you tell me whether or not you think these examples are racism, let alone pernicious racism. The first example he gave was the move toward requiring voters to show voter ID. Never mind the majority of blacks support voter ID. And never mind there are many states in the North, as opposed to the South, the alleged remaining still rampant racist southern states, that support voter ID. And never mind the Supreme Court ruled 6-3 that voter ID did not impose some sort of infringement on the ability to vote. And the person that wrote the majority decision was John Paul Stevens, who at the time was the most liberal Supreme Court justice up there. And that, in Eric Holder's view, is pernicious racism. Never mind the intent behind requiring voter ID, which is to ensure that people are not voting illegally. And what people will say is, well, there's no widespread evidence that people voting illegally is a problem. Well, do we need widespread evidence? We certainly have lots of instances where people have illegally voted. And we have that video where James O'Keefe, the guy that busted Acorn, goes to Eric Holder's voting precinct and says, I'm Eric Holder, I want to vote, and he's handed Eric Holder's voting ballot. Now, he did not, and he's white, Eric Holder is black, and James O'Keefe does not have a mustache, Eric, on and on and on. And you're telling me that requiring people to show voter ID is some sort of assault on voting, and that we have absolutely no concern whatsoever that people might illegally vote, when James O'Keefe could just simply walk into Eric Holder's voting precinct and ask for a ballot and get a ballot, and you're telling me there's no problem or there's no potential for problems? Are you kidding me? The second thing that Eric Holder said with pernicious racism is the fact that black kids are kicked out disproportionately compared to white kids in a given school. Now, never mind this is true of school boards, of school districts in Oakland and in San Francisco, where the school board is predominantly minority. And the third thing is that Eric Holder said that blacks who commit the same crimes have longer sentences compared to whites. That's true. But the U.S. Sentencing Commission says the reason is because of legitimate factors. Primarily, blacks tend to have a deeper arrest record, which judges take into consideration when they give a sentence. So these are examples of pernicious racism. You're telling people that when something goes down, play the race card, play the race card, play the race card. You get fired, must be racism. Voter ID, must be racist. Get pulled over by a cop, must be racist. Look in the mirror. Larry Elder here. Absolutely, quite positively, no S. It'll be interesting to find out about this black reporter's background. As you know, about 70% of black kids are now raised without fathers. He's young enough to have been in that 70% category. We'll see. Out here in Los Angeles, few years ago, there was a disgruntled police officer who was fired. His name was Christopher Dorner. And he put out a manifesto where he talked about how he was being jacked over by the LAPD because he was black, and then went on a murdering spree. Ultimately, he himself was killed. Interestingly enough, a number of officers were also complaining about what they call the Board of Rights a procedure, which is what the LAPD uses when they want to investigate and ultimately discipline, if not fire, officers. A lot of police officers, white and black, feel that the Board of Rights is unfair because they feel that they're stacked full of people that the police chief has put there. And so when the police chief indicates he wants a certain kind of outcome, that outcome is almost always preordained. That's at least the feeling. But it has nothing to do with race. It has everything to do with a system that a lot of cops feel is unfair. But rather than address the unfairness of what he perceived to be the Board of Rights system, Christopher Dorner assumed that the reason he got fired was because he was black. And this is what I'm talking about. This whole cottage industry of race baiters, race hustlers, people like the two professors that I debated when I went to New York and was interviewed on Al Jazeera. And because I dared to suggest that maybe, just maybe, racism was not the major problem in America, that had to do with families and bad schools and lack of appropriate job training and the failure of schools to produce people that can read, write, and compute at grade level, I got one of these professors turned to me and said, "Are you really black?" So Rachel Dolezal, who's white, got a great deal of empathy because she felt like she was black. Larry Elder, who is black, is deemed to be not black because I don't think like a black person is supposed to think like. I mean, this is where we are today. So you have a whole bunch of academics running around like Cornel West, suggesting that institutional, systematic, or whatever big long word he wants to use is the problem, as opposed to individuals' behavior and liberal left-wing policies that have encouraged people to marry the government and men to abandon, as you heard me say many times, their financial and moral responsibility. So it'll be interesting to see whether or not this particular reporter came from that kind of family. But even if he didn't, it's obvious that he's got a huge chip on his shoulder, has sued on more than one occasion, has accused colleagues on more than one occasion of being bigoted. Now, think about it. If you have filed more than one lawsuit and have had all these run-ins with your colleagues, and you still get jobs, as he kept getting jobs, how bad can the racism be? And rather than look at his own behavior and say maybe some of the criticism is performance-based, it's they're after me because I'm black. Now, I told you about the study that the Department of Justice ordered the National Institutes of Justice to conduct. That's a research arm of the DOJ into traffic stops and race. And it turns out 75% of black motorists said that they were pulled over for legitimate reasons. It also turns out that traffic offenses, every one of them, whether it's driving without a plate, whether it's driving without your seatbelt, whether it's driving without a car seat, whether it's speeding, every traffic offense was more likely to be committed by a black person than a white person, according to this study done by the Department of Justice. I didn't do it. They did it. And still we have this Black Lives Matter nonsense suggesting that white cops are murdering, mowing down black people, and there's been a rash of it. Never mind that over the last 30 years, police shootings of blacks are down 75%. Never mind that last year, 6,000 blacks murdered other blacks, and the blacks who did the murdering were not cops. Never mind that the number one preventable cause of death of young black men is homicide, as opposed to the number one preventable cause preventable cause of death for young white men is car accidents. But still you have this ridiculous Black Lives Matter movement, and then you have Hillary Clinton meeting with them, and you have Martin O'Malley initially saying all lives matter, got booed, and then he apologized for saying all lives matter. So all you're doing is giving fire to bogus allegations of race and racism. I was on Newsmax TV, where I'm an analyst, this morning, and we talked about the fact that Donald Trump has gotten apparently the endorsement of David Duke. David Duke says that Donald Trump is, quote, the best one of the bunch, close quote. And I was asked, shouldn't Donald Trump run away from David Duke's endorsement lest Donald Trump be perceived as racist? And I said, anybody under 50 years old probably has no idea who David Duke is. And what bothers me is the double standard here. And what I mean by double standard is you've got people like Al Sharpton, who's also said anti-Semitic things, referred to Jews as diamond merchants. During the Crown Heights affair, he urged Jews to pin their yarmulke on their heads and come over to my house and we'll get it on. And here he is running twice for president under the Democratic moniker, endorsed Hillary. It's going to endorse one of the survivors of the Democratic primary process. Is anybody suggesting that whoever Al Sharpton endorses renounce Al Sharpton because Al Sharpton has made anti-Semitic and racist statements? What about the late Julian Baum, the former head of the NAACP? He said on more than one occasion that Republicans are perfectly happy to have the flag of the Confederacy and the flag of the swastika flying side by side. Did anybody stick a mic in front of Hillary's face and say, are you denouncing Julian Bond for suggesting that Republicans are happy with the swastika? No, they didn't. What about George Soros? George Soros is probably the biggest donor, is the biggest donor to the Democratic Party and to left-wing causes over the last several years. He said George W. Bush had perfected the propaganda techniques that were used by the Nazis. Did anybody denounce him? Did they return his money? I mean, really? Bill Maher gave $1 million to the Democratic Party. Did they return the money because he referred to Michelle Bachmann, as we said yesterday, as a dumb T-word, four letters, and referred to Sarah Palin using the C-word? Did anybody suggest that any kind of money that Bill Maher gives is filthy money, dirty money, and should be returned? Indeed, he still has his show on HBO, still gets A-list guests, and nobody seems to repel from his show because of the comments he's made about Michelle Bachmann and Sarah Palin. But you let David Duke, a discredited former Klansman, who nobody even knows anymore, say positive things about Donald Trump, and it becomes news. I mean, unbelievable. Al Gore once said that George W. Bush unleashes digital brown shirts on the media because they don't like how they report. You know what a brown shirt was? Brown shirt were the shock troops that Adolf Hitler used along with stormtroopers to murder and pillage and plunder his way to power. Did anybody suggest to Mr. Gore that that was an unfair comparison? No. He went on and got an Oscar for An Inconvenient Truth. This is what I'm talking about. This is the disgusting double standard. And all you're doing are empowering people like Black Lives Matter when they make bogus allegations. You're simply giving them more and more currency. Give you a recent example of that. The LA Times, day before yesterday, I think it was, did a big suck-up piece on Al Sharpton and talked about how he is no longer an outsider. Didn't say one word about him being $5 million light in taxes, not one word about Crown Heights, not one word about the anti-Semitic statements that he's made, not one word about the fact that he's on an FBI surveillance tape talking about selling cocaine, not one word about Freddie's Fashion Mart, not one word about the group of people that he brought to the trial where the Central Park jogger defendants were being tried, with people chanting, her boyfriend did it, her boyfriend did it. He is one of the most vulgar anti-Semitic pieces of you-know-what in American life, and there he is with his show every single night on MSNB Hee-Haw. But David Duke endorses Donald Trump, and Donald Trump needs to denounce David Duke. Scotty, beam me up. I'm Larry Elder. Don't leave town.